Hello everyone, my name is Tanya Adhikari. Right now I'm pursuing LLM from Jogesh Chandra Chaudhary College, Kolkata, West Bengal. So today's topic of discussion is separation of power in Indian Constitution. The separation of power is a doctrine that has exercised the minds of many people. Ancient philosophers, political theories, and political scientists, framers of constitution, judges, and academic writers have all cause to consider the doctrine through the centuries. This mainly signifies the division of different power in between various organs of the state, executive, legislature, and judiciary. The theory of separation of power signifies mainly three formulation of governmental power. The same person should not form part of more than one of the three organs of the state. One organ should not interfere with any other organ of the state. One organ should not exercise the function assigned to any other organ. The separation of power is inimitable for the administration of federative and democratic states. Under this rule, the state is divided into three different branches: legislative, executive, and judiciary, each having different independent power and responsibility of them, so that one branch may not interfere with the working of the other two branches. Basically, it is the rule which every state government should follow in order to enact, implement the law, apply to specific case appropriately. If this principle is not followed, then there will be more chances of misuse of power and corruption. If this doctrine is followed, then there will be less chances of enacting a tyrannical law, as they will know that it will be checked by another branch. It aims at the strict demarcation of power and tries to bring the exclusiveness in the functioning of each organ. Then comes the basic our system, that is the three-tier mechanism of state government. It is impossible for any of the organ to perform all the functions systematically and appropriately. So for the proper functioning of the powers, the powers are distributed among the legislature, executive, and judiciary. Now let's go into further details of the functioning of each organ. Legislative. The main function of legislature is to enact a law. Enacting a law expresses the will of the state, and it also acts as the vein of to the autonomy of the state. It is the basis for the functioning of executive and judiciary. It is spotted as the first place among the three organs, because until and unless law is framed, the functioning or implementing and applying the law cannot be exercised. The judiciary act as the advisory body, which means that it can give the suggestion to the legislature about the framing of new laws and amendments of certain legislation, but cannot function it. Executive, it is the organ which are responsible for implementing, carrying out, or enforcing the will of the state as explicit by the Constituent Assembly and the legislature. The executive is the administrative head of the government. It is called as the mainspring of the government, because if executive crack up, the government exhausts as it gets imbalance. In the limited sense, executive includes heads of the minister, advisor, departmental head, and his ministers. Next come the judiciary, and the final one. It refers to those public officers whose responsibility is to apply the law framed by the legislature to individual cases by taking into consideration the principle of natural justice and fairness. So what is the significance of doctrine of separation of power? As it is a very well-known fact that whenever a large power is given in the hand of any administering authority, there are higher chances of maladministration, corruption, and misuses of power. This doctrine helps prevent the abuse of power. This doctrine protects the individual from the arbitrary rule. The government is the violator and also protects the individual's liberty. Summarily, the importance can be encapsulated in the following points. Ending the autocracy, it protects the liberty of the individual. Next, it not only safeguards the liberty of the individual but also maintains the efficiency of the administration. Next point, focus on the requirement of independence of the judiciary. Next, prevent the legislature from enacting an arbitrary rule. Constitutional statutes of separation of power in India. Going through the provision of Constitution of India, one may be ready to say that it has been accepted in India under the Indian Constitution. So, there are three heads under Indian Constitution, that is the legislature, which is the parliament, which includes Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, and the state legislative body. Second comes the executive, that is the all central level president and all at state level governor. And third most is the judiciary, Supreme Court, High Court, and all other subordinate courts. The Parliament is competent enough to make any law subject to the conditions of Constitution, and there are no restrictions on its lawmaking powers. The President power and functions are given in the Constitution itself, Article 62 to Article 72. The judiciary is self-dependent in its field, and there is no obstruction with its judicial functioning either by legislature or executive. The High Court under 226 and 227 and Supreme Court under 32 and 136 of Constitution are given the power of judicial review, and any law passed by the legislature can be declared void by the judiciary if it is inconsistent with fundamental rights. By going through such provision, many jurists are of the opinion that doctrine of power is accepted in India. Before looking into case law, so let us understand what is the meaning of doctrine of separation of power in strict and in broad sense. Doctrine of separation of power in a rigid sense means that when there is a proper distinction between three organs and their function, and also there should be a system of check and balance. And in a broad sense, it means that when there is no proper distinction between three organs and their function. In the case of IC Golaknath versus State of Punjab, the constitution brings in actuality the distinct constitutional entities, that is namely the union, territory, union and state. It also has three major instruments, namely judiciary, executive and legislature. It demarcates their jurisdiction minutely and expects them to exercise their function without interfering with other functions. They should function within their scope. Next, that is, in the case of Indira Gandhi versus Raj Narayan, the court held that in our constitution, the doctrine of separation of power had been accepted in a broader sense, just like in American and Australian constitution, where a rigid sense of separation of power applies, is not applicable in India. According to Justice Chandrachur, the political purpose of the doctrine of separation of power is not widely recognized. No provision can be properly implemented without a check and balance system. This is the principle of restraining, which has in its precept in it and the prudence of self-preservation, that discretion is better than its valor. In Ram Javaya versus the State of Punjab, Justice Mukherjee observed, In India, this doctrine has not been accepted in its rigid sense, but the functions of all three organs have been differentiated, and it can be said that our constitution has not been a deliberate assumption that functions of one organ belong to the another. It can be said through this that this practice is accepted in India, but not in a strict sense. There is no provision in constitution which talks about the separation of power, except Article 50, which talks about the separation of the executive from the judiciary. But this doctrine is in practice in India. All three organs interfere with each other function whenever necessary. Although there is an explicit provision in constitution, just like American constitution, that executive power is vested in president under Article 53 clause 1 and in governor under Article 154 clause 1, but there is no provision which talks about the vesting of legislative and judiciary power in any organ. We can conclude that there is no rigid separation of power. At the first instance, it appears that our constitution is based on this doctrine itself, as the judiciary is self-sufficient and there is no interference either by the executive or legislature. Court also prohibits the administration of judiciary is not to be discussed in the parliament. Power of judicial review and to declare any law void is given to Supreme Court. The judges of Supreme Court is appointed by president in consultation. Chief Minister and judges of the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court can make rules and regulation for the effective conduct of business. However, Article 50 of the Constitution of India talks about the separation of the executive from judiciary as being a directive principle of state policy, but it is not enforceable. Certain privileges, power, immunities are given to the member of parliament under 105 article. This provision makes the legislature independent. The executive power is conferred on president and governor. They are being the exempted from civil and criminal liabilities. But if we read carefully, it is clear that doctrine is not accepted in rigid sense, but the executive is a portion of the legislature and the executive is accountable for its conduct to the legislature, and also it derives its authority from the legislature. Since India has a parliamentary form of government, a mutual connection and coordination between the legislature and executive is very important. As executive power is vested in the president, but in actuality the real head is the Prime Minister of India, along with councils of minister, and president is only a nominal head. Judiciary also performs the administrative action while formulating the regulation and giving guidance for the subordinate court, as well as perform legislative power by framing the rules regulating their own procedure. So it is presumed from the provision of the constitution that India, being a parliamentary form of government, does not absolutely follow the idea of separation of power, but there is an amalgamation of the power where the connection between the different wings are inevitable, and it can be drawn from the constitution itself. Every organ performs all types of function in one or other form, subject to the check and balance by other organ. All three organs are interdependent because India has a parliamentary democracy. This does not mean that it is not accepted in India. It has been accepted, but it is accepted up to a certain extent. But when it is expressly provided that one organ shall not perform function of the other, then it is prohibited. In Delhi law case, it was stated that the legislature should exercise all the power of legislation only in extraordinary circumstances, like when parliament is not in session or emergency. We can say that the legislature is created by the constitution to enact the law. In India, there is no separation of power, but there is separation of power. Hence, in India, the people are not stuck by the principle but by its rigidity. For example, the cabinet minister exercises both the executive and administrative function. Article 74, clause 1 states that it is mandatory for the executive head to comply with the advice of the cabinet minister. In Ram Jawawa versus the state of Punjab, it was held that the executive is a part of the legislature and it's accountable. If we talk about the amending power of the parliament under Article 368, it has been subjected to the concept of the basic structure held in Keshavananda Bharati versus state of Kerala. In this case, it was held that the parliament couldn't amend the provision in such a way that violates the basic structure. And if it is made in violation of basic structure, then such amendment will be declared as unconstitutional or null and void. Going through this case law regarding the Supreme Court judgment, it can be observed that the basic structure cannot be amended and strict applicability of doctrine can be seen. Although in strict sense, the doctrine of separation of power is not followed in India like the American Constitution. The system of check and balance is followed. However, no organs are to take over the essential function of other organ, which is the part of the basic structure. Not even by amending, and if it is amended, such amendment will be declared as unconstitutional. And in reality, sometimes it is very difficult to separate the work of government organs into watertight compartment, and sometimes they do overlap each other. Thank you.